5 minutes to wait karne yaar. Let us be about 5-10 minutes or something. People will come. So I am, I was in a VMMC and I was retired as additional DG from the Ministry of Health. And I am teaching now in a private medical college, Subharti Medical College, Meerut, in Uttar Pradesh, UP. And with me is a professor, V.K. Malik, also is a professor in ophthalmology in my institution, and a very efficient phacoemulsification surgeon. Professor Ruchi Goyal, everyone knows that she is Joint Secretary of All India Ophthalmic Society, and she is professor at Guru Nanak Eye Center, New Delhi, and very prominent, eminent oculoplasty surgeon, and of course, phaco and all other things. So I think we can make the beginning, whatever you really can't. Let's see whatever, because these keep on happening, repeating and all that. First day it will be same, I think, everywhere. So I invite Professor Ruchi Goyal to give her talk on capsular axis in capsules which are difficult or subluxated cataract, so that we face at times. And she can take in between, if she has the slides, if the Rohit Om Prakash is not here, that if you run away, the axis is running away, then how do you handle that? And that happens very often in intumescent cataract and hard cataract and swollen cataract and Morgagnon cataract. So running off the axis also is a problem. So she can take that also. So she has a time. Dr. Ruchi Goyal, please.
So good morning, everybody. And we are very happy to be in Coimbatore. Anybody from Coimbatore, it's a lovely place. And to start right away, I'll first be sharing, I think, the basic principles of capsular axis. Whenever we are doing a capsular axis, we have to remember that our forces have to be in such a manner that they are controlled. And how does this control come from? That your forces have to be sharing force. When I mean sharing force, you can see there are two diagrams, one on the left side and one on the right side. On the left side, when you tear something apart, there it is going in opposite directions, 180 degree apart. So if you try to tear a paper like this, you know, your control is lost and you have to use a lot of force. Vis-a-vis, if you use a sharing force where, you know, you roll up and evert that area which is tearing and the forces are acting about 90 degrees apart, you have a controlled kind of a the rexus that is obtained. Now, when we are doing a rexus, suppose a situation arises that your rexus starts moving in either, you know, outside towards the zonules, or it is becoming too smaller, you can interchange these forces. Like if you have a rexus which is running towards the zonules, instead of sharing force, you can again, you know, make an opening and try to tear it outwards. So you can use this interplay of forces, but remember one thing. When we are using these forces, there is a force which is coming from backwards. You know, the whole lens diaphragm is going to push it up. So when you are trying to use this force, your chamber has to be deep enough so that you can counter this pressure. So once you start your capsular axis and you feel that your chamber is shallowing, you must keep on injecting viscoelastic agents so that this pressure is, you know, kind of obliterated and you are pushing the lens iris diaphragm backwards. So that is important. Now, this is a concept. See, the main thing is, as far as possible, we can all do phaco, we can all do SICS in patients where we are rexus is, you know, not adequate. But at the end of the day, our aim is that even if it has gone, you know, escaped somewhere, you have rest of the capsule done in a CCC manner, that is in a circular manner. Now, this is a concept for, you know, beginners, where this article we published in Contact Lens and Eye. You see, you start with a capsular rexus and you feel that your rexus is getting, the everted edge is getting crumbled. So what you can do is you can simply use the second instrument to bring it back and evert it on the anterior surface of the lens capsule. So this is a very small, you know, innovation, and but it really helps. The other thing is, sometimes we have seen that most of us, we are doing capsular rexus under viscoelastic agents, but sometimes we have very milky kind of cataracts. So if you have very milky kind of cataracts and, you know, that fluid keeps on oozing out, So what you want is that you want clarity of media when you are doing a capsular access. So you can create a side port and you can use an anterior chamber maintainer as an additional tool. We don't need to use it in every patient. And what happens is that instead of using viscoelastic, you perform your rexis under anterior chamber maintainer. So once the fluid starts leaking, it continues to flow out, the milky fluid, and your clarity in the chamber is maintained. So this is a very small innovation, again, that helps. Now, my topic was to speak on subluxated cataracts. So when we talk of subluxation, the subluxation is going to vary as to the amount of clock hours. It may be just 3 clock hours, 6 clock hours, 9 clock hours, or even more. And depending on the number of clock hours, what device you're going to use is going to change. The other important issue is what has been the cause of the subluxation, whether it is a congenital subluxation, maybe let's put it ectopia lentis. In those situations, what we see is that the remaining zonules are very good. If you have something like pseudo exfoliation or there is some other reason for a progressive subluxation, then in spite of the fact that there may be a smaller subluxation, but progressively you expect that the zonules are going to become even weaker over the time. So you have to choose your device carefully. The other thing is, whatever device you're going to choose, if you're using these devices, these are, this is a capsular tension segment. These are the capsular tension rings. These are modified capsular tension rings, also called as CONEs. You need to have an intact capsular axis. That is the bottom line of any subluxated cataract. So to have an intact capsular axis, how do you proceed? Because as I told you, there is a pressure which comes from backwards. You have to counter that pressure. So let's see how we can work it out. Now, this is an ectopia lentis patient. So in spite of a very large subluxation, I'm easy to maneuver my axis very comfortably. Now, I have to start from an area which is not subluxed, that the zonules are intact. So I start from here and I need not make a very large rexis. That's another important thing, because most of these patients, the nucleus is going to be soft and easily aspirated. Unless, of course, you have patients where pseudo exfoliation is there and you have hard cataracts where you expect the nucleus is going to be large. So, you can see this is another patient where rexis has been, again you see the subluxation is so large, it is extending almost till say about 5 clock hours. Now classically a CTR is indicated for just up to 3 to 4 clock hours of subluxation. In this patient I actually did not have a CONE at my side or a CTS, so I decided to put a CTR. Now this CTR can be inserted before you do a hydro dissection and do aspiration, or you can put a CTR even before you start the procedure. So this is another patient of traumatic cataract. You can see this capsule is torn from here. So what I did was I changed my site and I created a capsular rexis at an adjacent site. I'm not showing you the nuclear management because my topic was only capsular rexis. So once you see the lens has been removed, and you see these are very soft cataracts, most of them traumatic, and you get away with whatever procedure you choose. This is a CONE being implanted. This is a partial thickness scleral flap which has been created, and from this bed 1.5 millimeter from the limbus, a straight needle on 9-0 proline has been passed. This is tied onto the eyelet of the CONE, and remember this eyelet is at a level which is above the capsular excess margin, so it is in the sulcus. So you have to remember that you don't have to pass this needle in through the capsular bag. And once you put this CONE into the place, it kind of stretches the bag and it also helps in, and as I said, the rexis being smaller, you can go for foldable eyewells which are more easy to implant if you are putting it in the bag instead of the PMMA lenses. Now, this is a very interesting patient. This patient came, if you see this photograph, I'll just start the video. This is a post-traumatic subluxation with iridodialysis, which is extended almost 180 degrees. You can see this, the iris has come here. He had also got a secondary glaucoma, and you can see that the lens is cataractous. So Initially, we were very skeptical of saving this bag. I told him that most probably we'll have to go for a scleral fixated lens. Then I decided to try and see what how we manage this, and this really came out well. So before you start anything, of course, you need to stain your entire capsule. This is the viscoelastic being injected, and this entire iris, which had rolled back on the entire surface, is again brought to its position. So this was the first step I did. And once this is done, this is a side port being created. Now see how you can use these iris retraction hooks to keep this iris away from your port. Otherwise, if it keeps, now this is the rexus being done. Now this entire capsule had lot of scars also. You can see there is a scar. So I started with the rexus, then I realized that I was not able to manipulate with my cystodome. So this is a forceps being used. Now the forceps is a very useful tool in subluxated cataracts. And once my rexus was done, the same iris retraction hook is now used to pull, retract both the iris in its place as well as keep the capsular bag in its place. So same hook has been used to hold both the things. A very gentle hydro dissection. The nucleus fortunately was small. So now you do a phacoemulsification with very low parameters so that you don't have, you know, sudden collapse and all that, because it's very difficult to control this bag. And this is the IA I like to use. You can see there is a fibrosis even in the posterior capsule. But how easy things become once the iris and the lens, the capsular bag are held by the retraction hooks. Now this is a partial thickness flap that is being used. Nowadays I prefer to use a capsular tension segment which is very small in size and easy to insert. So I've used a capsular tension segment, and you can see this is again the straight needle which is being passed from the port, and this is brought out through the main wound. And once it is brought out, again, this is a CTS, the capsular tension segment, and this eyelet stays above. Remember, it stays in the sulcus. So once you put it in the bag, now when you're passing this, you have to be very careful that this needle doesn't traumatize the capsular bag. So these loops, they go into the bag and this hook remains above. That's the beauty of this device. And now I had two options. This is how you anchor this. This is a proline which is tied. I used a PMMA lens because I had to enlarge and suture all this iris. Otherwise, you can go for a foldable IOL in this patient with a CTR. See, you put a CTS to anchor the bag and a CTR to spread the bag. So instead of using a foldable IOL, I have used a PMMA lens to spread the bag now. So you can, you know, the permutation combinations can vary and you can go ahead and do anything. And this is after washing and everything and suturing the iris. You see, I had a very nice post-op result. Oh, this is the patient, very happy post-operatively. We don't have a speaker, so that's why I'm continuing. I know it already. So to conclude, one has to, whenever you have a patient with subluxated cataracts, you must differentiate whether it is a localized. If it is localized, say about 4 clock hours, you go for a CTR. That will work. If it is between, say, let's about 180 degrees or maybe 6 clock hours, you can go for a single CUNY. I don't like to put a double CUNY. It's a very cumbersome instrument, and it, while inserting the device itself, it damages rest of your sonews. So you can, instead of using a double CUNY, I nowadays prefer to use a capsular tension segment. You can use 2 capsular tension segments if your subluxation is large. And whatever you do, you must have an intact capsular rexus. Why so? Because if you don't have an intact capsular rexus and you try to pull the capsular bag, so what will happen is the whole thing, the tear is going to wrap around and you will have a PC tear also. And also start with a smaller rexus. Don't try to go for very large rexuses when you have a subluxated cataract, because smaller rexus is easier to enlarge at a later time, and most of them would have softer nuclei. Begin at the area where the zonules are intact, and if the chamber is becoming shallow, repeatedly use high molecular weight viscoelastics. It will help in keeping and helping you to maintain the control on your excess. If there is a fibrosed area, it can be cut with scissors. You can take a vana scissors, or if preferably if you have those vitrectomy scissors, you can take it through the side port. And through the vitrectomy, with the vitrectomy scissors, you can give tangential cut onto the area which is fibrosed, and you can take a capsular excess forceps and enlarge it. And remember, always check what is the cause of this subluxation. Otherwise, if you have a progressive subluxation and you fix it at one end, you may have the entire capsular bag with the IOL dropping down at a later stage. So be very careful about that. And thank you so much for your kind attention.
So this topic is open. I think youngsters are there, and I think the seniors also here. Somebody want to add, subtract, take, seek advice, and want to ask her subluxated cataract problem, or a capsular axis problem, or CTR problem, and what is Sioni ring and what is segment. So I'll start asking something for you. One is Dr. Ruchi, that you have not sutured the dialysis. You
are
not.
I have. Sir, my topic was just the capsular excess, so I skipped on I cut short my video. In fact, the very reason I put a PMA lens was that I had to open it at multiple places, and I had to suture the dialysis. I did suture the dialysis, and in the post-op picture, the iris was in place, so it could not have happened without suturing. I did suture it. I in fact sutured it at two to three places.
So dialysis can be sutured in the section. You can make a small biplanar section on the limbus, and take the bite from the dialysis area and suture it on itself. Same needle, same suture, take the double bite, so you'll get a loop kind of thing, and you can suture with the loop. When you cut this knot, there will be three ends, not two ends. So that is how you suture with same suture. So there are no two ends to tie. There is one bite, one needle has come, take another bite from same area of the bed, and then you get a loop. So you have loop where there are two sutures and there is one suture. So you tie with the loop, and when you cut it, you will get the three ends. Clear? So you can suture the iris in the section itself. So what is that? Is dialysis. Second question, Dr. Ruchi, is the segments are very good. The difficulty is of obtaining them. These are called, this man from Canada, I think Indian origin, Ike Ahmed. These are called Ahmed segments. So Ahmed segments, where are available in India?
Sir, these segments are band kar diye phone baje ja raha hai. These segments are locally made Madhu instruments, very cheap. There are no Ahmed segments. I work in a government hospital. I don't get exotic stuff. These are just 500, 600 rupees local segments, which are easily available in Delhi. You can I have no financial interest whatsoever. You can just, I think, go to Madhu Instruments. They copy any device and it works. Doesn't matter. So you can use that. And it's available at K Medi Optics outside our hospital. And I'm sure it must be available at numerous places.
So Dr. Malik, want to contribute something to the discussion?
I think all the Indian and Madhu instruments are very good, and they get all the segments, and no financial interest, and I support the Dr. Ruchi.
So these segments are basically copy of the Ahmed segments. Ahmed segments are imported and they are costly, but you can manage a subluxated lens with these segments or Sioni ring. Sioni ring is a CTR with a little bit lifted area with a hole, which you can suture outside, where she had made a scleral flap. So it looks difficult, that subluxated lens with a cataract, with a fibrosed capsule, but if you are with the iododialysis, so very difficult situation. She has tackled well, but she is experienced over the years. She is doing so many of them.
Just be careful about one thing. I had made a mistake in a previous patient. These loops, whatever the eyelets, whether it is a CTS, that is a capsular tension segment, or it is a CONE, these are at a level higher than the main body. So these are supposed to be placed in the sulcus. So when you are passing a needle to hold on to these, the eyelets, just make sure your capsular back falls back. Otherwise, what happens is, in one patient, I made a disastrous mistake actually. I passed my needle through the capsular back. What happened post-operatively was, you know, all my labor was lost. The hole, I made a small puncture in it while passing my needle, and the whole tear, it spread around, and I had to eventually go for a proper scleral fixated IOL. So be very careful that I had used those, you know, retractors, if you watch the videos carefully. And when once I was passing this straight needle, what I did was I loosened the retractor. The video was cut short actually. I let the capsular edge fall back. I just retracted the iris, I passed my needle, and then again I caught hold of the, you know, capsular back, so that the capsular back would stay away from my passage of needle. So that is a very small thing, but extremely important to, you know, and nowadays I have stopped using CONE rings, because I realize these capsular tension segments are so small and so easy to put into the bag. You can just place them, you know, one place. If it's a very large subluxation, you can put it another place. And you have injectable CTRs available. They just go in like lollipops. It's just 500, 600 rupees again, the injectable CTRs. Again, I think Madhu Instruments is making that also. I'm not sure, because our residents write all the stuff. And it's so easy to inject, you don't have to fiddle at all. So a combination of these makes your surgery very simple.
I want to add that for cheaper things, if small subluxation is there and bigger axis, even a PMMA lens will act like a CTR. It will give the.
So that is a very good suggestion, that if you, but you have to do a little larger axis, not a small axis. And that has to be that a small dialysis, a small zonular dialysis. If it is a large zonular dialysis, then it is maybe difficult, but sometime PMMA lens acts like a CTR. That if you put it in the bag, it will spread out. So that is what happens. Yes, please. This is the mic there, beta. That side.
See, whatever the area of subluxation in your idea is, basically the haptic has to be used to spread the back. So that haptic should be in the area where your subluxation is. Suppose it is at 12 o'clock hours, my, you know, the IOL has to be vertical. If it is at 180 degrees, my haptic has to go there, because that's how it's going to spread the back. Exactly, exactly.
When you're putting a CTR,
yeah.
Then the
eyelet
should be like away.
CTR doesn't have an eyelet. A CTR is, it's just a ring. If you want, I can show you the diagram again. It's in my presentation. Ek minute, presentation fir dal dijiyega, please. Excuse me. Presentation on kar dijiye, yehi wali fir se ek minute. The presentation which was there, just open it up again. So a CTR doesn't have any eyelet. It is the eyelets. No, there are just small holes in the at the ends. They are not meant for. No. They are not meant for suturing. They are just meant to dilate in. Just to hold it and dilate in it, there is no role of, because it is at the same plane as the entire body. When we talk of subluxations which are more than 3-4 clock hours, and you want to suture it or fix the device to the sclera, then the concept of eyelets come in, and these eyelets have to be at a level slightly higher. I hope you got the concept. I'll just show you the diagram.
Yes, flat is CTR is flat. CONE is little lifted like this, and it has an opening. So suture has to go through this opening and go out in the sclera.
See, you are talking about these eyelets. These are just to dial the device inside. And I said nowadays, with the injectable devices available, in fact, you buy one device injector with it. And then what I did was, I found that what they had done was, they had taken an 18 gauge cannula, and they had put visco, and they had attached the 18 gauge cannula to the insulin syringe. So I just keep trying things, whatever works out for me. So what I did was, I loaded the whole thing inside the cannula and attached the insulin syringe and put visco in it, and I could actually inject the same device myself. I created the injector myself also. So you just buy one, see how the mechanism is working, work it out on your OT. There are things lying here and there, and you can devise your own instruments.
Thank you, Vita. Anybody else, please, want to ask about this particular topic, subluxated acid lens and REXIS, and placing the, you want to contribute, Dr. Kamaljeet, something? Please. Give her the hand mic. Professor S.P. Singh is a principal at Medical College, Allahabad, and he is a professor of thrombology. And done lakhs of surgeries in the camps and outside and everything. Very hard-working person. And he has all gray hairs because of hard work he does. Yes, please.
Yes, though I came a little bit late, but anyway, I would like to say a few words. In subluxated, I have a lot of series in the Phacoemulsification subluxated. I have done is very minimal to up to 9 o'clock hours of subluxation. So the main guideline for when to use the simple CTR or the Sionis with single loop or double loop, if it is subluxation less than 3 o'clock hours, then capsule tension is sufficient to stabilize the bag. But if it is more, maybe 3 to 6 o'clock, then Sionis with single loop is required for fixation of the bag. And if it is more than 6 o'clock hour, then definitely it requires Sionis ring with double loop. That is fixation at two places, that's 180 degree apart. The main, you know, as Dr. Ruchi very correctly said, that the CTR very easily can be inserted in the place with the help of injector or with the forceps. But it is really sometimes difficult to place the Sionis in the bag. Because once you are going in the bag, and you are placing obliquely, not horizontally. So what happens once you are rotating it? It escapes sometimes from the margin.
Sometimes.
For that, I have some innovative ideas that, with the help of another, with the assistant, the second hand, just press it at the where the this is going inside, at the margin of the bag, and slightly press it. So make the Sionis is little horizontal, so it will go easily. Otherwise, you want to rotate it because you are passing from outside to inside, so it is placed, is going obliquely. Once you will rotate, it will escape out from the bag.
Thank you.
So this is the one addition.
Thank you. Thank you. Just another query. So many things happened when you have subluxation of this much. Vitreous shows many times. So vitreous tackling you have not told.
So, of course, most of these traumatic cataracts would have, you know, an era of problems with in the same patient. This patient, fortunately, did not have any vitreous show. But of course, if you have a vitreous in the anterior chamber, at the very start, once you, of course, hold the iris bag, otherwise, if you start vitrectomy right in the beginning, the automated vitrectomy, it's going to cut your iris also. So you have to ensure that you have to do a vitrectomy before you do any capsular excess and clear off your anterior chamber. Your anterior capsule also will not stain till the vitreous is removed from your anterior chamber. So you have to go ahead and do a vitrectomy, just taking care that you don't injure the capsule during the process, anterior capsule. And also the iris, which in this patient was, you know, it was actually lying in the center. So you have to be very careful about these things. And once you have done a vitrectomy, then you can go ahead and, you know, further on do your maneuvers. But if you have done you should not go and indulge into a lot of vitrectomy. Otherwise, there is creation of hypotony. That also makes things very difficult. So, you know, you have to deal everything according to what the problem is. If you have lot of hypotony here, for once I would advise that you can put an anterior chamber maintainer at a site which is away from your subluxated area. If you put an anterior chamber maintainer, that's going to push the vitreous back and push your everything back, but main vitrectomy you have to complete before. Only thing is that you should not fix your anterior chamber maintainer in the area where there is subluxation, because that's going to further push your zonules back and you may end up in a problem. Option number two is you can actually go for pars plana ports for infusion cannulas. They are very good if you have good access to these type of cannulas. What they do is they keep your chamber deep, keep the globe in a good turgid state, and it helps in doing your future maneuvers.
So we finished this topic, interesting topic. Next speaker, Dr. Rohitam Prakash, is not here. Yes, third one is now Professor V.K. Malik, and he will be speaking on a hard cataract in end phaco. I want to add my comment about that, like there are in this country so many those kind of cataracts which are never seen in the Western world, America or Western Europe. And those hard cataracts are best dealt with small incision cataract surgery rather than the phaco. Small incision cataract surgery can make sure that your cornea is good. It can make sure that you are not getting PCR, because PCR rate is 4 times more with a hard cataract phaco than normal phaco. So with that, I'm not saying that there are machines now which are advanced where you can raise the vacuum up to 600 mm or 550 mm to do the handling of the hard cataract. There are machines which can break it into pieces. And it is said that femtosecond, of course, can break the nucleus. But for femto also, it's very difficult to break that so hard nucleus, which we get brown and black nuclei. And so for them, I advocate SICS, the small incision cataract surgery, which all youngsters must learn. So now the Dr. Malik from Meerut, our institution, he is got the maximum number of cataract surgery awards for many years from UP government. So he has done lots of cataract surgery, SICS and phaco. So he will tell you how to deal with the hard cataract in phaco.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Dr. KPS Malik, sir. Hard cataracts, brown cataracts, and the coming to black cataracts, they are as bad as the black-hearted persons. They can ditch you at any moment. So the difficult part is how to crack them. They are difficult to break, difficult to pierce. It's not running. So these are the few difficult things. Less of the cortex, so there is no epinuclear layer all the time. It is just the capsule and the nucleus. That's the total lens becomes the nucleus. And the zonules are also lax. So you have to tackle it 2-3 types. You can do a direct chop if it is a grade 3 and 4. You can do 4 quadrants, or you can do a stop and chop. And there is a one technique, the terminal chop, where you have to go below the capsule and then you can start, when that's difficult. So the direct chop you can do, as I'm doing here, and make a smaller fragments. Small fragments give you less power and keep a little higher aspiration so that these fragments can be sucked and phacoed easily, and with less of the phaco time is taken. And next day, that gives you the clearer cornea. So that is the one technique. The four quadrant technique seems easier, but I think the stop and chop is the most convenient to me, and you can also use that. So stop and chop, you have to take two things. First, you have to make a good trench, and then separation of the two pieces. But most of the times, we feel that we are an expert surgeon, and half-heartedly we do it, as in this case I have done. Half-heartedly, badly trench, half-hearted love fails. So here also, if you are making hurry in the brown cataract, you have to keep patience, and that gives you a better results. So here it was a very shallow trench, and I thought that I can do it, yes. So then you have to give more pressure and you leads to complication. Iris has been sucked up, and if you give more pressure, then zonules may give place. So again, I started chopping and I thought that, yes, it has been chopped. Again, it is a half chop. It's not, no piece has been separated till now. But after few experiences, you feel that you can do it. And you start sucking it and tried it, yes, feels that you are successful, but there is a somersaulting of the nucleus. It is turning upside down, and the hard edge usually tears the capsule where I have landed up, and there is a PCR. So you have to take care. You make a big axis so that your pieces may not give you difficulty in taking out of the axis. Make a uniform and deep trench so that you can break the nucleus easily, and on both the sides at least full trench should be there as far as possible your axis allows, because if you tear the axis then everything is over. So here you can see that there is a complete separation, and if proper division is there then you can start the chopping. As the in anemia you have to do the break bone breaking, the same way the posterior fibers are to be separated, because sometimes it's anterior separation and it comes again closer. You separate the two pieces and leathery cataract will come again the closer. So from the center and posterior side you have to make sure that the pieces has been divided properly and separated. As you have seen, even in chopping the apex remains attached, so you have to do the small pieces and you comes very easily. And then if you make a harder nucleus and your trench is not going deep, then you have to widen it up, because your sleeves sometimes make it difficult. So you make a trench, make it little wider so that you can go deep enough and you can get a red glow if possible, and then only you start dividing. So if you are making a little wider trench, then you can go deeper also. That is the point here I want to express, that you make like this a little wider trench so that you can go deep also, and never press it more. You use Phaco, I always use a pulse mode, but yes, you can use a continuous mode also initially in trenching, but in pulse mode it gives a less Phaco power and you get a better cornea. So you have to give a wider trench and a deeper trench here. And if the trench is good, you can divide it nicely. You can see it. Yes, these are the sides. Because if you have a high-end machines and torsional phacos, then this widening is not needed. So the problem is only for the middle-class persons. The rich persons, they have high-end machines. You can do, definitely, you become a better surgeon with the same technique and same nucleus. And the poor person, they are not worried because they go for SICS in the brown cataracts and black cataracts. So then also you can be happy, but the middle persons are in trouble always. We cannot run away with small loans as the big persons can run away with higher loans. So high-end machines are always happier. But here I have shown the techniques which with the middle class person can do, and with a very cheaper Phaco machines I am doing it, and you can get it happier very easily. Rotate the piece, make the small pieces, always make the small pieces, and then do the Phaco so that it will need very less Phaco time and you are happy. So if you can do this, you should do this. If you feel difficult, that even if the small axis gives difficulty even in SICS, because if you want to tumble the nucleus in small axis, then the zonules will give way. Here also, if you take a big piece out of the axis and it is not coming out, then it will give you the zonular dialysis. So best is the take home message is that the bigger axis directly proportional to the hardness of the nucleus, deep and wide trench, and then divide up to the apex, and center should be divided all the apex of the pieces should be divided separately, then start the FACO and take it, and then you can do it nicely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Malik, for a wonderful video presentation. Just to add a few things, now there are two issues we are dealing with: a heart cataract. Your first thing should be whether you have a second generation machine or a third generation machine. What is your chamber stability? If you have a machine which has a good chamber stability at 500 vacuum, if you have a heart cataract, it is better to go for a direct chop. That is the, you know, the stop and chop is not to be done in patients with very hard cataracts if you have a good machine. That's important. Why? Because is that if you are going to go for a stop and chop, you're going to use a lot of phaco power, and with this phaco power you're going to injure the endothelium. So if you have a stable chamber at 500 vacuum, now when we talk of direct chop, there are three types of direct chop we have to talk about. There is one is the vertical chop, one is the horizontal chop, and nowadays the third thing, which the terminal chop, which has come in, which is kind of a hybrid of the two. So classically what is said is that if you have a very hard cataract, there is no place for you to insert your chopper from the periphery, so you go in for vertical chop. And vertical chop is when you divide the nucleus from center and you pull it like this. So you make a small, you go in with your phaco power on, catch hold of the nucleus, use the chopper and you divide it like this. But what is over the years we see is that the nuclear fibers, they are oriented radially. So if you try to divide it from the center, you need to use a lot of power. So instead of using a lot of power, if you divide it from the periphery, why is it easier to do a horizontal chop? Because you do it from the periphery. So this new concept came in that if you, instead of holding the nucleus at the center, you hold the nucleus slightly towards the periphery, then and you start dividing from periphery to the center, you have an easier division of nucleus. Now the concept of the large rexus versus small rexus, all our classical textbooks, they describe that you need to use a smaller rexus for a hard nucleus. Why so? Because the small pieces, they kind of, if they keep coming out, they tend to hit the endothelium and they cause endothelial damage. But if you have to do a terminal chop or you have to divide the nucleus from the periphery, your rexus has to be slightly larger. If you make a very large rexus, the concept is that your IOL optic has to be covered about 0.5 millimeter by the rexus margin. That will prevent the PCO. If you go in for rexus size 7 millimeter or so, this property of the, you know, the lens migration to prevent PCO goes down. So there is a, you know, kind of a compromise as to how much rexus size you need for this purpose. And as far as you know, the machines are concerned, suppose you don't have a very good chamber stability, you can always put in an NTHMM maintainer, which is what Dr. Malik is very fond of. Sir, you would like to add on that?
Yeah. So I would say that I don't know, people are scared of putting NTHMM maintainer. It's such a small tool costing 200 rupees that you put it in the chamber at parallel to limbus at 7 o'clock or 5 o'clock. And this takes work of the costly machine of 50 lakhs, that it doesn't allow chamber to collapse at all. So whatever vacuum you use, 500 or 400 or 550, that if you have anti-chamber maintainer, the fluid is coming from the bottle, and whenever there is a deficiency of the fluid, it will fill it up immediately. So anti-chamber maintainer for hard cataract is a, means boon, it's a really boon. Second thing I want to say, that you are propagating this terminal chop, I don't know. This is one term came with the one doctor from Delhi. At least he could not explain to me that terminal choke basically means that you have to put the choke right at the periphery of the nucleus and bring it towards the center and then separate the nucleus. The anatomy of the nucleus is such that if you break it from periphery, as she says, if you open the nucleus, you will find sometime it has a layers and layers like onion. That you keep separating periphery, and then you find the hard nucleus. So I don't find many radial fibers. So that radial fibers concept, in fact, fibers are not like this in the lens. Fibers are like this, like this, like this, and then you have a Y-shaped that suture on the anterior posterior.
Combination.
Periphery, it is easier because once you break that, then you get a very easy access to separate it, and then it separates whole. But danger there for me remains because Rexis margin can be accidentally broken there. You can have a complication there. Or you have to pull out the nucleus out of bag too far away towards you. And since these hard nucleus are large in size also, they occupy the whole bag. So there is no space for them to move around much. So hard nucleus are in fact are not easy to do what he has done. As I told you, PCR rates are more in hard cataract than the normal cataracts. And anti-chamber maintainer, of course, and the new machines like these Centurion and other things, they give you help. But SICS definitely give you the best results in the very hard cataract. Dr. Kamaljeet Singh, I told, the professor of ophthalmology in Allahabad, and again a very expert surgeon, commenter and teacher.
I find that there are so many young people sitting here, and basically when you have a hard cataract we are dealing with, as Dr. Malik has very rightly pointed out, most of the surgeons prefer stop and chop, and they are expert in that. So my suggestion is that whatever technique you are doing, don't change your technique for the hardness of the cataract or softness of the cataract. Since you are young, you will be dealing with just one technique, and the best technique is to go stop and chop. And what you have to do is that you have to go deep into the nucleus. If you like, the nucleus is like this, it's convex. So you have to go, the movement of the phaco should be like this, going like this, like a shovel. You go like this, go deep in the center, then you come slightly shallower in the periphery. Then you rotate it, as Dr. Malik has shown you, and after rotating it 180 degree, when you find that you can easily go, and the best thing for any hard cataract is without breaking the backbone of the nucleus, you don't proceed further. This is the basic point that I've learned from all the masters of phacoemulsification. Without breaking the backbone, that means you have to do a good crack. If the crack is complete, then you can easily do all kinds of surgeries without any problem. So make a deep trench, very deep trench. Initially what you do is that you make a shallow, as Dr. Malik had shown in that video, very good video actually. So because if you are a shallow, you cannot give due pressure on the walls of the trench that you have made. So you go, and for breaking the backbone, what you have to do is that you have to take the, your two instruments, you can take two choppers, or you can take a phacoemulsification probe and a chopper, and then you go deep into the floor of the trench that you have made. What mistake we do is that we try to separate the two fragments superficially, so then it becomes a problem. And every time, don't forget to inject viscoelastic material. Don't do anything in shallow anterior chamber. And AC maintainer is a boon. Whatever machine you have, if you are using AC maintainer, your technique will become much easier, and there would be a clear cut transparent cornea the next day. So these are some of the pearls that I wanted to share with you. And if you break basic thing, you remember this in life, that you have to first break the nucleus into two pieces, then you go into further high vacuum and then chop it.
Yes, ma'am. Malik, you can come here.
Yes, good morning, please. Sir. I totally agree. Managing heart cataract is giving an anxiolytic for the patient and one or two anxiolytic for the surgeon as well. That was a feeling for many years. And with active fluidics, I've been one of the users of Centurion Phaco machine. The Ozil technology certainly complements the technique what we are following, and the cutting efficiency of the balanced tip, using the balanced energy system, is very much complementary in managing the harder cataracts. And we do have to agree that more than 30% to 50% of our cataracts on day-to-day basis are all harder ones. It's not the ideal diffuse homogeneous white grade 2 cataracts. So adding to technology, of course technology is very expensive, but very efficient, and harder cataracts have been better managed with the higher vacuum and lower energy using the active fluidics. And I'd like to add the soft shell technique also, so that the endothelium is protected all through the procedure. And I would suggest that after removal of each fragment, just stop and introduce a viscoelastic and then carry on, so that we have a clear cornea and the closed chamber technique again.
Yes.
So the chamber is very much supporting all our procedures, every step we make is what I wanted to add.
Very good, and I would support this point of madam that in hard cataract, as many times as you inject the visco, especially dispersive visco, cheap ones, no Hylone, no viscote, not the shell technique or anything, we don't have that fancy things. So inject the methyl cellulose, which will cover the back of the cornea all the time. So more time you inject the visco in the hard cataract, more time you have a better chance that your cornea is protected. Other thing I wanted to add is like, again, this is my way of doing, and people possibly may not, may know. I don't do the bevel up. I don't do the bevel up trenching. I do the bevel down trenching, especially in hard cataract. I believe if I do the bevel down, possibly energy of the phaco is going in the lens rather than the cornea. So, and bevel down, and then I do is that in the center when you are going from 12 o'clock to 6 o'clock, try to punch the center more. Try to make the center deeper. If you make center deeper, then separation of the two halves are easier. So these are few additional things. You wanted to add something?
One thing I wanted to talk was that using a sharp chopper vis-a-vis a blunt chopper. There are two kinds of choppers which are available. If you have a very hard nucleus, you should go for a sharp chopper and not a blunt chopper. And the other thing is the the torsional phaco, when we are all very fond of using torsional phaco, whoever, I think most of the people nowadays are going in for these kind of machines. So when you, even if you use 100% torsion, when it's a very hard nucleus, please change your settings to some linear mode also, because purely torsional phaco is not going to work for you.
Ma'am, one more question. Can we use burst mode in this hard cataracts?
Yes, well, absolutely.
How do, when then how we should use, which steps we should use?
See, basically the concept of burst mode is that the power, once you set in, it reaches the maximum and it stays there. Of course, the pulse would be there, but it reaches the maximum once you press the in the first go. So if I usually go for a direct chop, so it really doesn't matter as to what mode we are using, but when you are trying to aspirate, it is at that stage, because when you are trying to hold the nucleus, you don't need to leave the nucleus, you need to just hold on to it. So once you catch the nucleus and then you try to eat it, then the thing comes into play.
Hello, doctor. Just now, I think we will be running for time now. Please, your name and place and then speak. Yes, please. Mic tick kar dijiye jara.
I do direct chop. I did started doing. Then I did the bowel and chop. See, in direct chop, we do not know till what depth our tip has gone to. In bowel also, we have a
saucer,
curved surface, saucer
shaped.
But now what I have seen, if I do direct trench, I know the level of the nucleus where I hold, where best to hold. I hold in an advantageous position. I directly trench, go to a depth in the nucleus, then I chop. I usually, in the most hard cataracts also, I can easily divide into two. And once you are divided into two, rest is easy. And regarding viscoelastic and this thing, but one thing which, in spite of, there's a viscoelastic is a must, but once we do at the level of the capsular axis margin, and once our chopper work is over, even with the Sinsky, we can keep the nuclear fragment down so that we do it at the back hurry. The results post first day post of it are very good. Thank you.
Thank you. I think I have two topics, so I can take them together. You can speak that finisher. So I'll speak Dr. Kamaljeet to speak his topic, and then last I'll speak my two topics together. Nahi hai usme? So so okay, I speak.
So aage.
So this is again a very important topic, and again, Dr. Kamaljeet Singh and me like persons are, we are villagers, so we treat villagers and we live in village and we are down to earth. So we deal that We believe that majority of people in this country can't afford the 50 lakhs machine or 1 crore machines or 2 crore machines like Femtos or a Infinity or Centurion. So we deal with the machines which are 10 lakhs rupees or 11 lakhs rupees, and we make the almost as good results as anybody else. Please, Dr. Kamaljeet.
Thank you, sir. Sir, my humble suggestion to all of the senior faculty members here, sitting here, and the younger ones, is that we have to find somehow the technique which is cheaper. And we remember Dr. Daljeet Singh and Dr. Jan Wurst talking about the cheaper technology that we have to adopt to. Buying a FACO machine costing 70 lakhs is, I always consider, stupid. Because in a training center, you should have 6 or 7 machines so that your residents can learn. Our job is to teach, not to do the surgery. So we have to find ways and means by which our cheaper versions can be made very good. And AC maintainer is one such thing which is very useful. My request is that you keep on using that and you will be better off. Now, when the chamber is shallow, that is a very, very difficult situation, and many a time you come across this during surgery or pre-operatively also. So, if you have a, this is the chamber anatomy, and if you have a shallow chamber, then you have a big problem. What happens is that in the normal chamber, you have a good volume, wherein you can maneuver your instruments within the entire chamber, but when it is shallow, the volume becomes very little. It's a fraction of cubic millimeter which is left there, and then you have to work on that. And both these structures, the cornea and the iris and the ciliary body and the posterior capsule, they come forward, and the surgery becomes little difficult. So you have to be careful in dealing with a condition where you have a shallow entire chamber. So corneal endothelium can be damaged, or posterior lens capsule can be damaged if you are not very careful. Now, as we were discussing, injecting a high viscosity OVD at in AC is very, very important, and that will give you a good space to operate upon. But important thing here to realize is that you have to never overinflate it. If you try to overinflate the eye with an OVD, it can raise the IOP and the problems will come up. In an excessively shallow chamber, what you have to do is that you can do a small pars plana vitrectomy. A dry vitrectomy can be done. If you are not comfortable with pars plana vitrectomy, you can call your vitrectomy surgeon. He will do in just 30 seconds. And then your chamber, when you will operate, the chamber will become deeper, and you can easily maneuver the things. So this can be done, but the problem is that if you are doing yourself, then there are risks to the retina, and therefore it should be done by the experts, or if you are used to doing vitrectomy, then you can easily do it. How to deepen the anterior chamber in a shallow anterior chamber is important. What you can do is that you can raise the bottle height. In normal FACO machines that we have, you can always raise it or you can bring it down by hands or by automated technique. Hand is, we have lots of people around in the operation theater, so anybody can raise the stand there, and the height of the bottle will become high. And the second important thing to remember is that you have to use a lower flow rate in these kind of complicated situation. You should use a lower flow rate. That is important, then the surgery becomes easier and simpler. And you should take care of making a good watertight incision. That is very, very important. For not having surge, what you have to do is that you have to be careful in making the incision. And as always is said, that as you make the incision, so goes the surgery. So it's very important to make a proper incision, watertight incisions. And infusion pressure can be increased by the various methods that we have discussed. So If you are not comfortable, then initially you have to start with a lower height of the bottle and then later on you increase. Because many a time, if from the very beginning we have raised the height of the bottle, then the iris will start coming out and things will coming out. And then the second thing that you can do is that you debulk the nucleus. That means that you eat away the cortical matter that is there, the AP nucleus, that will give you some space to operate upon. And this is a small video. This was a case. This was a case. Isko rokne ke liye kya karein? Hamara lab. Yes, stop it. Now this was a case which I was trying to do just 2 weeks back, and I stop kar de. So I was trying to do, and suddenly I found that eye became intraoperatively very hard, and we gave them mannitol. The chamber became absolutely flat. There was nothing there where we can operate. So what I did was I postponed the surgery, and then on next OT after giving mannitol, the pressure did not come down, and then we thought that we have to do it, and we did. This is how we did. You can start now. So we go like this and making two side ports. First we try to do irrigation aspiration to eat away the nuclear material. We had done capsular access in this case, so then it was not done during this surgery. And we tried to finish off these matter, but it did not come. We tried to debulk with the help of the Phaco probe, and a little bit of the matter was eaten away. But again this chamber became shallow. So then I asked my vitreoretinal surgeon, Dr. Vinod Singh. He made a small pars plana vitrectomy, he did. And then I tried with the Simco also to have some space. And once it was achieved, then we kept on injecting viscoelastic material, but the chamber was, then after that when vitrectomy was done, it became much easier. And we could finish off the surgery without any problem in this case. So these are some of the steps that you can use and can finish off the surgery without any problem in this case. That's all, sir, I wanted to discuss. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Kamaljeet. So these are difficult problems. What we discussed today in the FACO is one of the most difficult problems, that you have got a lens with very shallow chamber, and they may be the lens induced glaucoma, maybe lasting for 10 days, 15 days, a month. Then you have peripheral anti-SINK. Then you can really not deepen the chamber by anything, except mannitol you may give many times, and you don't even realize that what harm you are doing to an old person when you give a mannitol many times. So avoid that. So till you remove a part of vitreous, this chamber would not form. Anterior chamber maintainer also can't form it. You give a nick and iris jumps out. So you really feel that what can I do? I can do nothing. And if you don't have vitrectomy surgeon and do this trocar and all that, I am doing for whole life, 3.5 millimeter behind the limbus. I take 18 gauge needle and I put a suture there in the sclera before that, where I make a small nick and put a suture. I put the 18 gauge needle and suck a vitreous 0.1 cc or 0.2 cc, and immediately you will find the tension goes down, the chamber becomes, and then you can enter the chamber and you can do the surgery. And then you can tie that knot on the 18 gauge needle. You can do a little bit of cautery around it. So danger of retinal detachment is not there, because this is that area where vitreous surgeon is doing everything every day. So if I put a 18 gauge needle or 20 gauge needle, it would not produce anything retinal until unless I withdraw whole vitreous. It's a 4.2 cc vitreous, so I don't withdraw 1 cc vitreous. I would withdraw 0.1, 0.2, 0.3 vitreous. 0.2 vitreous is enough. And then chamber becomes, the tension comes down. Then you can inject visco in that anterior chamber and can do your surgery. I think you will agree with that. If you don't have the vitreous surgeon, you can do with some kind of a needle. Take a little vitreous and
So vitreo retina surgeon here will
Sir, exactly the same procedure I also follow many a times, but since we have the facility of a
vitreo retina surgeon,
so
my vitreo retina surgeon is will generally refuse that I don't have time, I don't want to come. So he will say keep it tomorrow or keep it after day after tomorrow. So anyway, because when we are living in a situation where there is nobody around to help me, I have to invent my way.
And sir, if you can do anterior vitrectomy, you can also do through pars plana. It's very easy. It's
you can
only
do that
just
you can
since
do that.
That day Dr. Vinod was there, so I said ki yaar jara isko dal do yaar, tum to jara easy ho jayega.
So
record bhi karna tha.
To ye problem hai and everybody faces it.
Yes,
and
sir.
Mostly they feel that let me refer it to somebody, and referral also he will also face same problem. So anybody want to ask question or anybody want to give their suggestion?
I would differ a little. Once you make these ports, you must do an anterior vitrectomy at least at the port, so that you don't leave any traction bands, and you should not pull on it, because later on, right now the patient will go home, later on he may develop an RD. So be very careful, and you must take a high risk consent before you do all these procedures. Even in government hospitals, and we are continuously having litigation, so one has to save one's skin before you go in for these kind of procedures. And sorry sir to contradict.
Now
you,
we have Dr. KPS Malik, the master SICS surgeon, and I have learned whatever I have learned, all the tricks, and many a times I repeat his words in many conferences. So I have learned so much from you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I will be speaking on this topic of posterior polar cataract. One thing is I believe, which again so many will contradict me, especially Dr. Ruchi Goyal, she contradicts everything what I speak. Posterior polar cataract is overdiagnosed. It is overdiagnosed. Whenever you see anything hard at the posterior capsule, you say it is a posterior polar cataract. And when you do surgery, everything comes out so well. So majority of the time, the posterior polar cataract is not there. So it is just some kind of a dense posterior subcapsular posterior cataract, and not the posterior cataract, because there is no definition of the posterior polar cataract. Let's accept that we say that this cataract has the invagination in the vitreous, and the posterior capsule become little concave there. It becomes thin there. Of course, it becomes thin there. But pre-existing hole in the posterior capsules is very rare, very rare. Chala ye yaar, not working. Yes. So it is associated with abnormal adhesion of the posterior capsule to the polar opacity, pre-existing weakness of the posterior capsule, and disposes the eye to posterior capsule ruptures. We know it that when it is real posterior capsule polar cataract, then PCR rates are high, and you sometime have to tell the patient and relations that this is possible, that you will have the, where we put the lens, that membrane may break, and then we might have to adopt something else, vitrectomy has to be done. We might sometime get a complications like that, we have to do the fix the lens or so many things. So, and posterior polar cataract is bilateral in 90% of cases. The category is PPC with imminent posterior capsule dehiscence, PPC with pre-existing posterior capsule dehiscence, and spontaneous dislocation. But when you do the hydro dissection sometime, you find that you are doing hydro dissection and nucleus disappears. So with me it happened once, but it was not a posterior polar cataract. It was possibly, again, the arrogance and ignorance, I call two words, that complications mostly occurred with either arrogance, that I have done so many surgeries, I do cataract in 2 minutes, I inject everything wherever I feel like. So you do the hydro dissection and inject so much fluid that it breaks the posterior capsule if it is weak, and nucleus sinks. So most vitreous, the nucleus sinking will occur by the hydro dissection, or it will occur when you are doing the phaco and you have not noted the large opening in the lens, especially in the hard cataract, and then the nucleus or part of the nucleus may disappear. Otherwise, PCR should not be that large that your nucleus disappears, but in posterior polar cataract during hydro dissection it can appear. Spontaneous dislocation and falling down, that can happen. And this is appearance of the
posterior polar, what you would diagnose that the bullseye appearance, that in the center you have got that dense and those kind of onion shaped kind of peels. This is posterior polar cataract. And management, so it's a routine management, and you do the axis. And then no hydro dissection, you do the hydro delineations, and it is something like I go deep and give a burst kind of thing, that you break an atom bomb within the meat of the nucleus, meat of the nucleus. Don't go posteriorly anywhere, but when you inject it, it will break out inside out kind of way, the lens will break out. And then you start eating the portion which is free to you, and that don't bother about the posterior part which is white adhered with the capsule. Slow motion technique with the low irrigation aspiration. You removal of the cortex, and when that white thing sometimes doesn't get free, I do the visco dissection. I go with the visco from both sides, and visco will dissect out that posterior thing, white thing. And visco will do it so gently, it would not break the posterior capsule. So once it is done, of course, then you can inject the avoid rapid build of the hydraulic pressure in the capsular bag, mechanically cushion the posterior collar of ST during surgery. Low aspiration and flow parameters, prevent sudden shallowing of chamber and forward bulge of virus capsule bag. So don't allow really that the bag should collapse many times, and the chamber should collapse many times. In the event of PCR, optimum management by performing a PCCC, again that posterior capsular axis, it is said more often than done more often. So we preach it, but practicing the posterior capsular axis is not that easy. How many of you sitting here have done the posterior capsular axis? Three have done, four have done. Yes. So it not every time you would not succeed. Every time you would not succeed. So sometime do you succeed if you have got a very good vitrectomy machine and you have got a very good, in fact there is a micro uterata forceps which can go through the side port. Then that can do it. That can do it because it pulls delicately. Thank you. It's all about the posterior polar cataract. Just one film and to show you basic take-home message is that firstly, don't be scared because it may not be the posterior polar cataract. Secondly, wherever you suspect, wherever even there is a posterior subcapsular posterior dense cataract and you suspect it to be posterior polar, then do that hydro delineation, no harm. You do that hydro delineation, then posterior portion of the nucleus remains there. So you take out the superficial one and then do the visco dissection of the posterior part. Go from side, inject the visco and this will lift up. And then you can take this up. At least I have seen that most of the time I have succeeded without breaking the PCR. Some of the films I have not brought, but you can really see the dimple, that this is a concavity there, that the capsule has become thinner than 0.3 micron. We say it is 3-4 micron, but it may be 1 or 2 micron only. So that one has to be very careful that you don't keep a bottle height very high. You have a low parameters of the outflow and the vacuum and everything, so that this posterior capsule, which is supposed to be weak, doesn't give way. So that is the take-home message for posterior polar cataracts, so-called posterior polar cataracts, and you can succeed in most of them. And if, of course, there is a PCR, then you have to go from side, inject the visco, fill up the chamber, fill up the eyeball, and then manage like any PCR management is. If anybody has any query about this subject, can pose the question to the panel.
To add one thing.
Pardon?
with your permission, I want to add one thing or clarify the things, that usually in this way, the capsule doesn't give way by pushing inside the things, but it's the shallowing of the chamber, sudden shallowing the chamber. So here, anterior chamber maintainer is the best thing. Or while you are coming out with your Phaco probe or IA, then from the side port, you should push the visco and you can prevent the PCR here. Thank you.
Again, I would not agree with you people, because this posterior capsular dehiscence, if it is there, it is pre-existing. It is nothing to, you know, be created de novo.
In every posterior polar cataract?
No, it is not there in every posterior polar cataract, but the dictum is that you have to think that there would be a dehiscence until unless you don't find it. All our maneuvers are directed towards preventing, you know, our nucleus piece or cortical pieces from falling into that pre-existing gap. And the basic pathology is that through the gap is already there, and the, you know, the contents are fibrous and they are stuck onto it. That's the basic pathology. So one has to proceed in all, you know, this cushioning and hydrodelineation inside out to maintain the last, you know, plate on top of it is all directed towards that. So here, anterior chamber maintainer, I don't think it's going to work out in any way. If it is there, it is there. Only thing, your maneuvers have to be slow motion, so that, and this one thing which is important is the sudden collapse which you can stop, is that while you withdraw your main port, you can start injecting your hydro, your viscoelastic through the side port. That is how you can keep maintaining your chamber all through. You don't really need additional devices for this particular, you know, kind of a situation. Sir, I think
basically,
basically
there are two things. One is posterior subcapsular cataract, the other is posterior polar cataract, as sir has pointed out. In the posterior polar cataract, all cases do not have deficient posterior capsule. It's around 20 to 30% true posterior polar will have deficiency. But all the care, as Dr. Ruchi has told you, that you have to take all those precautions so that the nuclear pieces should not go. And you, if you have a pre-existing posterior capsular deficiency, then you will be in problem. So the last piece that should come out is in the central. That is very important. Secondly, your vitrectomy machine should be ready in all these cases. Without that, you don't proceed in any posterior polar cataract. These are two messages, and further they have already discussed.
Yes, that, you know, I believe, I agree with that, that there will be cases where there is existence, there is already pre-existing PC rent. It is there. To my experience of 44 years,
yes, sir,
I have about two cases where I was sure that when I reached from the periphery and everywhere, I knew that there is a rent. And then, of course, you have to deal with
sir,
the rent.
Sir, I am half your age, but I have at least experienced 5 to 6 pre-existing deficits. So,
we can proceed to the next talk, because
God is kind with us, doesn't send us the pre-existing tears. So, next topic is again very important topic. Yes, please. Yes, please. Thank you.
So I thank you, you are my guru.
Thank you.
So secondly, sir, that should we consider, many times we have unilateral adrenal field type appearance, but other eye is normal.
Yes.
So can we consider it is not posterior capsular?
Yes, yes.
In all cases?
Because 90% are bilateral. So you think that it is a 10% chance that it has, but most probably it would not be posterior polar.
Thank you.
You can do an NDS segment OCT for a definitive diagnosis.
But OCT, go to send the patient to Guru Nanak Center.
I would like to add one
give him the kiraya of 3,000 rupees coming going from your
sir,
place.
I am also like your acolyte. I have been being your student for a very long time. Sir, in posterior polar cataract, mostly the anterior layers are clear and it grows very slowly.
Yes.
And in that case, we can. What I do is, I spend a long time seeing over slit lamp.
Doctor, we are running out of time now. I think outside we can discuss, because I think other people are coming for the next session.
All right, sir.
So I have just 5 minutes to go, and this is again a big topic, prevention and management of PC tear. This is cause of tears is bad day. Like astrologers should tell you that you have a good day or bad day today. I don't believe that.
but surgeon factors and difficult case. Patient and surgeon's comfort is must for avoiding the PC tear. I believe that you go with a cool mind, with long breaths, many of them, you can have a prayer or whatever, that when you have a difficult cataract case, then counseling the patients and you counseling yourself and being happy, being peaceful, your seating arrangement, your instrument, your pedal, your all these things should be quiet, that you are comfortable to begin with. So you are not running around here there. So this is, she is counseling the patient, and then we are adjusting the seats before starting the surgery, that nobody moves and shouts that mera stool upar karo, mera niche karo, mera pedal lao. So we welcome Dr. Sudhir Singh, again our SICS master and FECO master, but he fights with people. I don't fight with people. He should not fight with people. That I now no longer fight with people. So cause of PC tear can be surgeon and difficult cases. Dr. Ruchi, please guide now what is to be done. ACM in shallow anterior chamber to avoid the posterior capsule rent. As Dr. Kamaljeet Singh showed you very well, that anterior chamber maintainer gives you so much support of the deep chamber and prevent the collapse of chamber. And collapse of chamber is the one reason for the PC tears. And hard cataracts, of course, again, the incidence of the PC tears are more. And we prefer, we advocate good SICS, which give the best results with clear cornea and no phaco power, zero phaco power. All machines are coming with the... Yes, and this is just technique that... avoid the spider, you will see the spider that is about to rupture. So be careful when you are doing IA also, they can rupture. And this is rough surface ACM I used, and tear is produced by the ACM. So if you have got a old ACM, Simco, film kahan gayi bhai? That we managed also. So don't allow the chamber to collapse, remove the chopper, but let the photo, the phaco remain there in position, inject viscoelastic through the side port, inflate the capsular bag with viscoelastic. If the tear is still small, implant a single... So these are... tamponade with the ocular visco device, and then you can take away the remaining portion of the cortex or nuclei or whatever. So you can use the phaco after PCR also. Only thing is that you have to be careful that don't allow that PCR to enlarge. See, that is the PCR there, and then we implanted the lens because there was no vitreous there, no vitrectomy was done. And this is another case with posterior fibrous capsule. We have to cut it, a traumatic cataract, and you cannot do the round capsulotomy. So these patients' capsule virtually has to be cut with seizures or whatever, and there is a pre-existing tear already. In a traumatic cataract, you will find many times. Do the vitrectomy in these cases. Do a thorough vitrectomy in these cases. And then you can put a lens before removing this cortex or anything, because I want that this tear should not enlarge much. So you put the visco and put the lens and then remove the remaining part of the cortex. So it will work like a scaffold to allow you that your tear would not enlarge. You can possibly put this lens in such a way that this whole cortex comes in front of the lens and you can suck it out. You can go in the periphery also, and you go with any instrument, and then you can cut out the big capsule remaining there on up. It's a fibrous capsule, so after putting the lens you can clear up the, and in the end you will get a good result. And many times upper loop fixation is that technique of mine, that we fix the, if there is a capsule remaining in lower part, then you can put the lower haptic there behind the iris, and then take this suture from the upper haptic back of the iris and in the section, same technique that you suture on its set. Or you can place IOL in second sitting, that we do many times. That first sitting we feel that this rupture is so large, you do the vitrectomy and then leave this patient and then call after 15 days. By that time, whatever remaining thing you can wash away, you can topical, you can see the rexis now, everything, and then see big rexis. When you have a big tear on the table sometime, you try to put a lens and it goes into the vitreous. It try to go in the vitreous. So sometime you are again that time panicky also, everything is raw, but after 15 days or 3 weeks, this become a hard capsule. And you can put the lens safely on this. And one technique I do these days, which I may publish soon, that again many people would not agree, that when there is a large tear and pupil is becoming smaller and you want that patient has a lens, but you can see the rexis was there in the lower half quite a bit, so we put the lens in the lower part and then I leave the loop on the one upper haptic on the surface of the iris. I leave it on the surface of the iris. After 2 weeks, when capsule become hard, I dilate it and then find everything, because lower loop has gone, upper loop I just dial in. So that is what two stages PCR management we call. We leave the patient with the IOL in the pupillary area, so he's happy also that he can see, but we don't take the risk of sinking the IOL.
Sir, and the time is up.
Time is up. Thank you very much, the audience and the faculties and all that. I hope you enjoyed our talk, and bless us that we keep on teaching you or learning from you. Thank you very much. Thanks. Thanks, Dr. Ruchi, Dr. Kamalji, Dr. V.K. Malik, and S.P. Singh, and Sudhir Singh, and Dr. M.C. Agarwal, and all the learnable and educated audience, which taught us also many things. Thank you very much. Thanks. Thank you.